from the titles.
Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Now, I've always enjoyed a good burger, and I'm one of millions of people around the world who've moved to a plant-based diet. So this thing is an entirely plant-based burger, and very tasty it is too. But let's be realistic. Moving to a vegetarian or vegan diet is something that many more millions of people around the world will simply never consider doing. In fact, as the developing world catches up with our Western lifestyle, it's a statistic that's actually going in the opposite direction. I'm not going to get into a debate about animal versus plant-based foods here though. For one thing, there's a massive variation in perception and opinion on the subject, depending on whereabouts you are in the world. In the UK and Europe, about 10% of the population follows a vegetarian or vegan diet. It's a similar number in Canada, and actually slightly higher in Australia at 11.2%, with 50% of the population now saying they're actively eating less meat. By contrast, the number of vegetarians in the United States is only around about 5%. And there's also a big variation in how livestock is raised and processed, depending on the country of origin and the size of operation, from independent smallholders through to behemoth mega factories. So it's a complicated and emotive subject involving not only the welfare of animals, but also the livelihoods of millions and millions of very hard-working farmers and landowners around the world. But regardless of which side of the argument you come down on, a couple of things are certain. Number one, we currently use about 50% of all habitable land on Earth for agriculture, and about 77% of that is for livestock. Number two, the developing world is growing fast, as this animation shows. As people reach a higher level of income, they aspire to eating more meat in their diet. And why wouldn't they? So as these developing nations continue to grow in number and in prosperity, so more and more land will be required, with a tendency to encroach on dwindling forestry land, stripping away more and more of an important carbon dioxide sink, and removing protective shade that allows nutrients to thrive in the soil below the tree canopies of the world. As this chart shows, if the world average moved from where it is today, just up to the level of my fellow Brits, then we'd need almost 95% of all inhabitable land just to feed ourselves. And with the best will in the world, that just ain't gonna work. So for some years now, scientists have been looking for what they regard as the holy grail of food production, and what some other people might think of as a portent of a nightmare dystopian future of Frankenstein monsters. I'm talking about lab-grown meat.
Captain, doesn't even look real.
It's not life as we know or understand it.
Also known as cultured meat or clean meat, the first ever lab-grown meat was produced at the Maastricht University Laboratory in the Netherlands back in 2013. It cost about €250,000 to produce a burger when they first started out, but since then, several startup companies have sprung up around the world in what's now become a race for market domination. And that's had the inevitable effect of driving the price down significantly to more like $600 to $1,000 for a quarter pounder today. Still way off the mark, of course, but I think you can see the direction of travel pretty clearly here. So how's it done then? Well, they take a tiny sample of muscle tissue from the animal, about the size of a grain of rice, and then back in the lab, the scientists grow stem cells from that tissue. Held inside a nutrient-rich liquid, the stem cells do what come naturally to them, which is multiplying up and growing into muscle fibers. According to one producer, Moser Meats, they can produce 80,000 quarter pounders from one muscle sample. And of course, the folks working inside this new frontier of food technology are quick to tell us that there are many benefits to pursuing this goal. So what are these benefits, and are they worth it? Well, for one thing, the scientists tell us that lab-grown meats won't contain any of the pathogens that you can find in meat from slaughtered animals, like E. coli, Salmonella, and Campylobacter. Why? Because meat grown in a lab never comes into contact with the intestinal pathogens or fecal matter from the animal carcass in the way that meat in big factory-sized processing plants can. And then there's energy and resources savings. According to environmental science and technology, depending on the animal type, lab-grown meat involves approximately 7 to 45% lower energy use, 78 to 96% lower greenhouse gas emissions, 99% lower land use and 82 to 96% lower water use than conventional meat production. But it's not all plain sailing for these new food pioneers. At this stage, there's two or three major hurdles that still stand in the way of mainstream production and acceptance by the public. The first of these has to do with the way the mussel fibres are grown in culture. Up until now, the nutrient liquid that the scientists have used to grow these fibres in has been something called fetal bovine serum, which is a protein-rich liquid full of all the right stuff for nurturing life, but which has to be extracted directly from the fetuses of unborn calves. And let's face it, you ain't selling that to anyone, are you? So unsurprisingly then, all of the half dozen startup companies that are working on cultured meats are frantically researching alternative serums that they can use to grow the stem cells into the muscle fibers that they need. One of the most prominent of these new companies is a US startup called Just. Already well known in the States for their vegan mayos and other dairy alternatives, Just are acutely aware of the ethical problems surrounding fetal bovine serum. Their research team, headed by Perendi Birdi, is looking for alternatives using similar proteins found naturally in plants.
So we're working on a lot of different experiments to find ways to eliminate that serum. So to do that, we're harnessing the technology from our discovery platform to find different proteins that come from plants that can replace the proteins that are in the FBS in that serum that comes from animals. And I think here at Just, we are very well positioned to do that because we have years of experience who have analyzing and understanding proteins from plants. Because at the end of the day, animals eat plants. Cows, for example, eat grass. So the proteins are similar enough. We just need to figure out the best ones that our cells are happiest with and grow naturally.
Hot on the heels of Just are a company called Moser Meats, who I mentioned earlier. In fact, it was their chief scientific officer, Mark Post, who originally unveiled the very first lab-grown burger back in 2013. They're backed by money from Sergey Brin, the co-founder of Google, and they're aiming to get a product to market within 3 to 4 years. But the one issue that neither of these companies has cracked yet, and the second of the three big challenges for the industry, is something that they call structure. You see, the cells that are currently grown, while technically meat in their chemical construction, come out as a random jumble of cells that can only really be used as a burger patty or the inside of a chicken nugget. No one's been able to get these cells to align into a structure that looks like a chicken portion or an actual steak until now. Out in Israel, a company called Aleph Farms say they've nailed not only the nutrient protein issue, but also crucially, the challenge of creating a steak-like product. They've been working on a kind of three-dimensional lattice work to provide a structure around which the cells can grow and organize themselves into the more steak-like article that you see here. Even though these samples are so far only about the size of a credit card and cost about $50 a piece, that's still a massive reduction from the 2013 prices that I mentioned earlier. Aleph Farms reckon they're about 2 years away from full commercial production of proper economically affordable steaks. And then there's finless fish. As far as I can tell, the only startup concentrating on growing fish products from harvested stem cells. As their website points out, fish is one of the healthiest proteins on the planet. It's high in omega-3, omega-6, DHA, and a host of other nutrients that help us thrive. And it goes on, we now eat twice as much fish than we did 50 years ago, a value set to nearly double again by 2030. And increasingly, our fish supply has become unhealthy as climate change and pollution fill our fish with unwanted additives. With rising levels of ocean pollution and fish farming, contaminants like plastic, mercury, growth hormones, antibiotics, herbicides and fungicides end up lurking in our favourite fish and seafoods. And when we eat them, those nasty substances end up in us. Finless Fish are starting by producing bluefin tuna, a fish that has recently been threatened by predatory fishing practices. They use exactly the same basic 5 steps as the meat producers, and their aim is to produce real fish fillets and steaks in the fullness of time. Although, as you can see in their promo video, they're still only at the fish cake stage so far. Nevertheless though, a very encouraging set of breakthroughs. But the third big bogeyman for these companies will be regulation. In the United States, the Food and Drugs Administration and the US Department of Agriculture have agreed to share regulatory oversight of lab-grown meat for the US market. meat production is a $200 billion industry in the US, so it's no surprise that a fierce debate is bubbling up between conventional meat producers and these new startup enterprises. There's even argument about whether a foodstuff can be called meat if it's not the product of a dead animal. Ultimately though, if the product is right, which in this case means if it looks right and tastes right and if it's at the right price, then people will buy it. And if that happens on a global level, especially in countries like China, then we'll be saving a massive amount of forestry land that would otherwise be stripped and cut back for livestock grazing and the growing of cereal crops to feed that livestock. And that has to be a good thing for all of us. That's it for this week. No doubt there'll be some very strong opinions on this one, so please feel free to leave your thoughts in the comments section below. Try and keep them civilized if you can. If you found the program useful and informative, then please do give it a like and share the link with your friends. You can also subscribe to the channel, which shows you support for what we're trying to do here at Just Have a Think. And you can do that absolutely for free by clicking here. As ever, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week. And remember to just have a think. Now, if you'll excuse me. Good.